Good morning, friends. It's great to be able to gather and to worship remotely with you as we once again consider God's word to us. Psalm 121 begins, "I lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." And for the people of Israel, as they sang that song, they were actually usually making their way to Jerusalem. It was one of the Psalms of Ascent. And what they were saying was they were looking up toward Jerusalem, where the temple of God was. And the understanding was that was where God dwelt. And so they lifted up their eyes to the hills, and they understood that their help came from the Lord, from God himself, the maker of heaven and earth. And as we gather and worship, as we look around and consider the things that are happening in our own world, I think it is good to look to God, to remember that he is our helper and he is our strength. So I invite you now to pray with me. Oh God, thanks for this day. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for encouraging us. Thank you for being there for us in the midst of all that is around us and all that surrounds us. God, we are grateful that you have gone before us and that you promise to be with us. God, that's the great promise that Jesus gives to us. So now would you guide us and lead us as we worship, as we sing, as we reflect, as we pray. Lord, as we consider once again the great beauty and wonder of who Jesus is, would you guide us? We pray and ask in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Folks, let's come before our Lord now for a time of prayer. Please pray with me. Lord of all, we thank you this morning for your love and goodness, for your grace and peace, for your strength and power, for your majesty and splendor. We praise your name that you call us to come into this place today and worship you. As you have led us here and now, you have also directed our spirit's gaze at the narrow gate, the way, that harder road that leads to life in you. Teach us each new day how to live into your life-giving way. By the beacon of your Holy Spirit, teach us to discern and then to avoid those false prophets and false guides, those evil people who sometimes swirl around us. Protect us from them, O Lord. Even more, Give us the depth of faith and obedience to recognize the good fruit from the bad, not merely in others, but even more importantly, in ourselves. Keep us from thinking so highly of ourselves that we somehow lead others astray. Remind us that the consequence of bearing bad fruit could even be our own destruction. Keep us, then, from the self-deception of a faith that believes it's doing your will, yet is actually carrying out our own will. Root out all hypocrisy in us, O Lord. And then, by the wisdom and clarity of your Spirit, help us to produce and be influenced by the good fruit. Even now, you call to our heart the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. We thank you that there is no law against these, and we pray that you will nurture them in abundance in our lives. Crucify any false passions of ours by that blessed passion of your cross, Lord Jesus. And in that sacrifice, remind us of the price that was paid for our redemption, our salvation. Then, as you did the work that your Father called you to do, help us to be not merely hearers of your word, but doers of it also. By the light of your Spirit, give us the wisdom to build our house of faith, not on sand, but on you, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. For we pray it in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, online worshipers. I'm Scott Mitchell, one of the pastors on staff here at La Jolla Presbyterian Church. We're so glad you're worshiping with us today. As you know, there's a lot of things going on at LJPC. If you'd like to know more about those opportunities, you can check your email for church news or Zoom details, or you can go online to ljpress.org, or you can check out our church Facebook page. We hope you'll be joining us this morning for our virtual coffee hour fellowship time. It starts right after worship at 9:45 a.m. on Zoom. And at that time, you can take out your computer or your phone and type into your browser ljpress.org/Zoom, and then just look for the friendly faces. For those of you who are planning to go to in-person worship next Sunday, October 18th, we encourage you to get your RSVPs in early. You can go online to our website, ljpress.org, and then look for the tile that says RSVP. And that will then show you how to sign up either for the 8:45 traditional worship service or the 10 a.m. contemporary worship service. Or you can simply call the church and ask for Michelle Whitney, and she'll get you signed up. Do remember that the worship services are subject to the state COVID guidelines. We look forward to seeing you in person in worship next Sunday. Folks, LJPC has been incredibly blessed by God in these crazy times. And one of the main ways that God has been showing his goodness to us is by your ongoing generosity in these recent months. You have been amazing. By God's grace and your tithes and offerings, we've been able to continue doing our mission both locally and globally, as well as doing our programs here at the church. So as you are able, you can give in one of two ways: by giving at our website, ljpress.org/donate, or by mailing a check to the church. Our address is 7715 Draper Avenue, La Jolla, California, 92037. And we thank you again for all the tithes and the gifts that you have been able to share with us. Well, those are just some of the things that are happening in the life of LJPC. There are a lot more, and so if you'd like to know more about them, you can go online to ljpress.org. Yeah.
Good morning, friends. It's a beautiful day for a drive. And did you know that in San Diego County, there are over 10,000 roads? That's a lot of places to go and a lot of ways to get lost. Nowadays, we can look at Google Maps or Waze or other apps that can tell us immediately not only how to get where we want to go, but give us several options and even tell us if there's traffic. Before all these fancy apps, though, we had this book called The Thomas Brothers Guide. Ask your parents or grandparents about it. First, you had to find out where you were. So you'd look up your address in the back. And that would tell you the page and the letter and number to start on a grid. Here we are in La Jolla. Next, you'd find the address where you wanted to go, and then find its page and square and figure out a path that would connect the two places. Now, Thomas Brothers couldn't tell you if there was traffic. They couldn't tell you if there was a quicker route. So a lot of times there would be a surprise along the way, like an accident or a detour. And if that happened, you'd pull over and look at the map again for another way to get to your destination. Eventually, if you followed the steps, it would get you where you wanted to go. Did you know that Jesus said that each choice we make in life is like taking a step down a road? And there are two roads that he describes. One is flat and easy with a wide gate at the end, and the other is narrow and rugged and challenging with a tiny opening at its end. He said that most people take the easy road, which seems to make sense until you see where that road leads, which is away from Jesus. He said that few people take the narrow road, which is more challenging. I can understand that, because there's a part of me that wants life to be easy. But Jesus said that the narrow road leads to eternal life with Him, and that is worth any challenge. So, each choice we make in life takes us either closer to or further away from Jesus. Now, we can't drive in two directions at once, can we? You see, Satan wants us to sin, so he makes sin look tempting. The good news is that we get to make our own choices, not Satan. We get to decide if we're going to take the way that's easiest, but will eventually lead us to a dead end, or if we want to take up the challenge and follow the road to Jesus. Now don't worry, because you don't have to do it alone. God gave us our very own roadmap, the Bible. And he sent the Holy Spirit to guide us when those decisions get tough and the road gets narrow. So are you up for the challenge? I knew you would be. Let's pray. Dear God, you gave us your Son to die on the cross and pave the road for us to come to you. God, would you help us to look at your directions, your word in the Bible every day, and to call on the Holy Spirit when we have trouble with challenging choices. We want each choice we make to bring us closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Friends, it's great to be worshiping with you, and I just want to start off by saying thank you and give a little update on our finances and how things are going. We are 3 months in to our new fiscal year, July, August, and September, and your donations have been right on track. They're actually better than we had anticipated, and so I want to say thank you for that. I want to thank you for being a part of our mission drive-thrus. We have a picture that we're going to show of the money that was donated for one of those drive-thrus was to buy shoes, new running shoes for the City Heights Runners, which is a ministry of urban life, the ministry we started several years ago. And if you see these kids, this is half of the kids we were able to buy shoes and socks for. And so we're grateful for your support of that, for them to be able to go to Roadrunner and to be able to buy shoes and to do running, which really helps them in terms of growing in their own understanding of who God is. They do some teaching with those students, and they also get great physical exercise. So thank you, La Jolla Press, for your faithful giving and allowing us to be able to minister to those students at Urban Life. I don't want to also want to let you in on a little, and not necessarily a secret, but something about our actual budget for the 6 months that we are in. As you recall, we took kind of a conservative approach to our budget. We weren't certain what the full year was going to look like, and so we just simply budgeted for 6 months. But we also weren't certain what income was going to look like because of the pandemic. And so we anticipated a 10% reduction in our operating budget in terms of income. And in order to kind of balance the budget, and then what that meant is we had to reduce our budget or our expenses in terms of particularly within our program expenses by 20%. So every department was cut by 20% in order that we could have a balanced budget and keep our staff that we have. We didn't want to lose any staff either. So what happened, though, which I thought was awesome, was some of our ministry departments said, we actually don't even need that much money because the programs we normally run are not going to be able to happen. And they took those extra funds they would have normally been allocated and said, we want to give those to mission. We don't want our mission partners to not be able to get what they normally receive from La Jolla Press. And I think that's important for all of you to know, that our staff and our elders, we are committed to doing the mission that God has called us to using all of our resources, whether our time, our energy, but even our money in a way that glorifies God. And so I just think that that's important for you all to know, that as we continue on, that we want to be about supporting our mission partners however we can, supporting Urban Life, supporting Ebenezer, supporting all the great mission projects that we are engaged in. And the staff is committed to that as well. So I say thank you to the staff, and I also say thank you to the church. You all have been amazing in your generosity. So thank you so much for that. And as we move into the second quarter of this fiscal year, we know that December is always a big month for our church. About 20% of our operating income comes in December. And so we know that God will provide. And I just want to say thank you for your generosity and your faithfulness. So when I was in kindergarten, I found out that I needed glasses. I don't remember all the details and what exactly that looked like, but I remember at one point going to the eye doctor and doing these eye tests and reading different letters and trying to read different sentences and having the apparatus put on your nose. And when all was said and done, the doctor said, "You need glasses. You're farsighted and you have astigmatism." And so I remember walking out of the eye doctor's office and walking into the quote unquote showroom where they had their glasses. Now, if you remember back in the 70s, if you were a 5 or 6 year old kid who was told they needed to wear glasses, here were the options you had. You walk out and they said, "We have these black frames or we have these brown frames." Two options, that's it. Black or brown. And none of them were very stylish. This was way before the days of Warby Parker and kind of these hipster eyeglass stores that we have now. There were two choices. There was brown or there was black. And I went with the black ones. And then every year when I got my eyes checked, again, the choices were brown or black. Two options. About that time in the early 70s, you may recall, if you're old enough to remember this, a commercial that Burger King released about the Whopper. "Hold the pickles, hold the lettuce, special orders, don't upset us. All we ask is that you let us serve it your way." And what they were doing was they were going against McDonald's, of course, and the Big Mac. Because they were saying, if you come into Burger King, you have options. You have choices. If you don't like this, you don't have to have it. If you want to add this, you can add it. And this idea of saying there's more than just one way or two ways. There are options. I remember reading an article a couple of years ago, the chief marketing officer of Starbucks said that when you walk into a Starbucks, I remember this was 2 or 3 years ago, there are 80,000 different drink combinations that you can order. 80,000. Well, in our text this morning that we're going to pick up, as we're talking about finding our way, this 9-week sermon series we have on talking about discipleship. What is the path of discipleship? We're going to hear from Jesus. Jesus didn't believe in a lot of options. And what we're going to read is Jesus said, there's basically two options. And it is not just necessarily Jesus that thought this way or said there's only two categories or there's only two ways. We actually picked this idea up way back in the book of Deuteronomy. As God is preparing Joshua to lead the people into the promised land, this is what we read. This is Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 19 and 20. And listen to how there's two options. "This day I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you," now here's the options, "life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live, and that you may love the Lord your God. Listen to his voice and hold fast to him. For the Lord is your life, and he will give you many years in the land he swore to give your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." God says, I'm setting before you two things, life or death, blessing or curse. And God says, choose life. In the text that we're going to read today, it's interesting because Jesus is finishing the Sermon on the Mount. The beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, you may recall, starts with this idea of blessing, and he talks about, it's kind of this short course in how we are to live as Christians. But then as he wraps up the Sermon on the Mount, he has some strong warnings, and it's all about choices. One way or the other way. Two paths, two gates, two types of prophets, two types of disciples, two foundations. It's either or. And so I want you to listen now for God's word. We're in Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 through 27. We're moving now to talking about what does it look like to become like Jesus. We spent the first three weeks talking about following Jesus. But what does it mean? What does it look like tangibly to become like Jesus? And what he's going to argue here is we have to learn how to be obedient. So this is Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 through 27. Jesus says, "Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. For every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit, you will recognize them. Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?' Then I will tell them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers.' Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash." To become like Jesus. That if we're thinking about this path that we're on, if we're thinking about this journey that we're on, we're thinking about finding our way, we must do more than just follow Jesus. We must become like Jesus. And what Jesus does in these stories that he tells, he says, it's not just listening for my word. It's doing my word. It's living out my word. It's being obedient to my word. And Jesus says, as you do this, you need to know I'm with you. If you think all the way to the end of Matthew chapter 28, when Jesus gives the Great Commission, he tells us that. And know I am with you till the very end of time itself. Jesus says, I will be with you. That's how you become like me. But he also speaks with great clarity. And people like clarity, but sometimes clarity can be offensive. And that's what happens in this text. It should scare us a little bit. Like if you're reading this and you don't think anything really big about it, it's a little daunting to read through it. It's a little daunting to preach through it. Because Jesus says, there's two ways. First of all, there's the narrow way and there's the wide way. There's the narrow path and there's the wide path. There's the narrow gate and the wide gate. Now, what's interesting is that word narrow that's used there. It has to do with pressing in. It has to do with compression. It has the idea, actually, of being difficult. So even in Jesus using the word narrow, he's describing a way that's not so easy, a way that sometimes presses in on you. But that word for wide, it actually has a connotation of prosperous. Because what happens when you're on the wide road, you think you are prospering, you think you are doing well, and in the end, Jesus says, no, you weren't. The way to life is the narrow way, but the narrow way means you don't get as many choices. The narrow way means that you work for righteousness. You care about the plight of your neighbor. You look for those who are in need. That's the narrow way. And Jesus says, if you want to become like me, you have to follow the narrow path. Then he talks about the prophets. And he says there's also a couple of kinds of prophets. And he says, you know, they do these amazing things and speak in kind of in amazing sorts of ways, but you have to look out for the wolves in sheep's clothing because they could lead you astray. And Jesus says, the way you know that a prophet is real is by their fruit. You must look at their life and see the fruit that they produce. It's interesting. Verse 19 says, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. The issue is not bearing bad fruit. The issue is not bearing good fruit. That the task of those prophets that he's describing there, that you need to look at their lives and say, are their lives bearing good fruit? And then he moves on, he says, and there's two types of disciples. There's the either or, there's this or there's that. And they're going to show up and Jesus is going to say, I never knew you. And that should scare us a little bit. I mean, that's a little daunting to think about. But we have to remember, that's God's deal to do that sort of judgment, not ours. And the verse that's always really helpful for me in this is Micah chapter 6, verse 8, which I use quite often, because I think it's a great barometer for me of, is my life bearing fruit? Because God asks this question. And it's at Micah 6 talks about God's judgment, and the people talk about, hey, maybe we can buy our way out of God's judgment. Maybe if we bring the right sacrifices, or we bring enough offerings, or we throw enough money at God, everything will be good. And then God asks this question in verse 8 of Micah chapter 6. So Micah 6, 8 says this, God has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. What is it that God requires of us? To do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with God. If we're wondering if our life is bearing fruit, like if that, and some of you get way too stressed out about this, so that's, you're not the ones I'm talking to. But for some of us, there is this thing of, how do I know if my life is bearing fruit? And I would ask you, do you do justly? Do you look for ways to act justly and to bring justice? Do you love mercy? Do you seek to bind up the brokenhearted? And do you walk humbly with God? Are you obedient? This is what Jesus is driving at, of saying, we have to rely on God. Deuteronomy 30, God said, you can choose life or death, blessing or curse, but choose life. And this is what Jesus wants us to do as well. He just offers some warnings at the end of the Sermon on the Mount. And the final warning that he offers is one that we're probably somewhat familiar with, of all these parables, or all these stories that Jesus uses. It's the issue of the two foundations. It's, what are you going to build your life upon? Are you going to go deep into the rock of Jesus Christ? Or in the story that Jesus tells, are you going to simply build on the sand? Jesus says, you don't just get to hear the word of God. You have to do the word of God. And the effort it takes is real to accomplish God's work. So you have to think now of what it's like to build a house in the Middle East. I've never built a house in the Middle East, but I've built one in Belize, and I've built one in different places. And what happens in the Middle East is they build their homes during the summer, the hot season, before the rains come. Because you don't want the rain coming and washing away all the good work that you've done. But the problem is, it gets hot, and the ground gets very hard, and very hard to dig into to actually get to the final foundation, or to get to the rock to have a foundation. Leviticus, now I know don't spend a lot of time in the book of Leviticus, but it's interesting, in a prophecy that God has about his how he is angered by the people of Israel, which is not a new occasion, but he says this in terms of talking about the ground, and this is verse 19, Leviticus 26, 19. God says, I will break down your stubborn pride and make the sky above you like iron and the ground beneath you like bronze. And what, you think about that. And the ground of Israel, it's hardened clay, and it's like bronze when you're trying to dig into it. So you're out there and you're building your house, and you hit this clay that is just rock solid, it seems like, and you're just tired, and it's hot, and it's miserable, and you don't want to do the work to dig down through that clay into the hard foundation and find the foundation and find the solid rock. And so you finish your house and you just build it on that clay and you put a roof on it and you think, hey, this will be good enough. And then the storms come and the rains begin to wash through your house, and that soil that you built on begins to get a little more muddy and soften up, and the walls of your house begin to buckle. And Jesus says, it's going to fall. And he says, this is what happens when you're not obedient, when you just simply hear the word, but you never put it into practice. Jesus, I want to suggest, loved the either or. One way or the other. It's not multiple choice. I think sometimes people want the faith to have some multiple choice components. And Jesus refuses to allow that to happen. I mean, that's how he ends this sermon here. He says, look, there's two ways. There's either or. That's like me and my glasses. There's black or there's brown. There's two ways. There's two paths. There's two gates. There's two types of prophets. There's two types of disciples. There's two foundations. So I'm going to ask you two questions then. Do you admire Jesus? Or do you want to become like Jesus? Do you admire Jesus? Or do you want to follow Jesus? I know that's kind of four questions, but they're saying the same thing. Do you admire Jesus? Or do you want to follow Jesus? Because here's the deal. It's very easy to admire someone. I watch Fernando Tatis play baseball, and I'm like, that guy is amazing. I love that he plays for the Padres, and he's fun, and he's active, and he smiles all the time, and he can hit the ball like crazy, and he can field the ball like crazy, and he goes all out 100%, and I admire him, but I'm never going to become like him. I'm not going to go out and practice baseball. And so this is the thing about admiring someone. It doesn't cost you anything. You just admire them from afar. And Jesus is saying, when you just simply hear my words, it's like admiring me. So the second question, do we want to follow Jesus? Do we want to become like Jesus? Because that's really what's happening here. Are we ready to do the hard work that Jesus requires of us? Admiration is easy, but becoming like Jesus takes work. And so we have to decide at the very end of the Sermon on the Mount, we hear about the crowd, Matthew chapter 7, verses 28 and 29. So when Jesus had finished saying all these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law. Jesus taught as one who had authority, but the crowd had to decide what they were going to do. Would they just admire his words? Would they just admire his authority? Or would they actually give up something and walk with him and become like him? Because Jesus, as we have seen in the Gospel of John, Jesus could lose the crowd because of some of the things that he said. Are we willing to do the hard work, to do the foundation level work in order to build our lives on Jesus Christ? Let me show you a picture of what it looks like when you don't build on a solid foundation. You probably recognize this place. It's now known as the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Of course, that wasn't its original name, but that is the name that it now has. Work was begun on it in 1173. And then in 1178, they decided to add the second story and started working on that. And at that moment, that tower began to lean. And for the next 100 years, it's fascinating because there were wars all around Pisa. And so the tower was not expanded upon. It just kind of sat there for those 100 years. And then it took them another 100 years to build it to the height that it is now of 180 feet. But that thing leans. And we know that by 1990, the lean was 5.5 inches. I don't really know exactly what that looks like, but I know we've got a picture of that. And so then they stopped letting people in 1990. And from 1993 to 2001, they did some more work on it and straightened it up a little bit. So now it only leans over 4 inches. Or 4 degrees, rather, not inches. So the interesting thing, though, is this. I went to the Leaning Tower of Pisa in 1989, right before they shut the thing down, when it was probably tilting at 5.3 degrees instead of the 5.5 that it got to by 1990. And my buddy and I, we had been traveling through Europe. We'd been in Florence. We'd been in Rome. And we'd all heard about, you know, the Leaning Tower of Pisa. And so we got on the train out of Florence and went out there to see it. And we arrived, and sure enough, it's leaning. And then, here's the amazing thing. We paid to climb to the top of Leaning Tower of Pisa. Not that that's weird, but I'm like, I am paying money to climb something that is a monument to being a failure. Like, they didn't build on the solid foundation. That word Pisa means marshy land. They built on the swampland. They didn't secure the foundation. And here I am, climbing 180 feet, paying for the privilege of walking to the top of something that wasn't constructed properly from the very beginning. Now, I'm sorry if you love Leaning Tower of Pisa. My apologies for you for that. But just think about that. It's a monument to building on the wrong foundation. And a tourist swamp there in order to climb up it. It's a very strange thing. But it was not built on a solid foundation. And so it began to lean to the point where they thought it might eventually fall. That's fine for the leaning, for the Tower of Pisa to be like that. But I don't want to live my life like that. I don't want to build on the marsh. I don't want to build on the ground where everything has the possibility of either sinking or leaning or falling. I want to build on the solid rock of Jesus. I want to be obedient to him. I don't want to look at the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, and just admire the Sermon on the Mount. I want to put those words into practice. I want to become like Jesus. I'll never be Jesus. He's fully God, fully human. I'll never accomplish that. But I want to do whatever I can to be obedient to his word. And I hope you'll join me in that endeavor. I hope you'll put in the effort to build on the solid foundation. I hope you'll look for the narrow way, because that narrow way brings life and hope. I hope you'll consider the fruit that you are producing, the way in which you are doing justice and loving mercy and walking humbly with God. Because when we build our lives on Jesus, as he tells us, we don't get to avoid the storms, but we will be able to weather the storms. And whatever life might bring our way, Jesus says, you're going to stand. You will be able to withstand whatever might come your way. And so as we follow Jesus, may we also become like Jesus. Pray with me, please. Oh God, thanks for this day. Thanks that you love us. Thank you that you have healed us. Thank you that you have restored us and set us free. May we be your people. May we become like Jesus. May we be obedient to his word and his voice. We ask in his holy and precious name. Amen.
Tis so sweet to draw.
And now, friends, we go into this world, finding our way in and through Jesus Christ, finding our path, building our lives on his solid foundation. May we become more and more like Jesus. And now receive our Lord's blessing as you go from this place. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and love of God the Father, fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, both now and forevermore. Amen. Jesus.